Solitude. Desolation. Confinement. These are all synonyms for isolation. Some of my favorite video games ever use isolation as a core element of the gameplay, and for some intangible reason, feeling alone feels so good sometimes. I think part of the reason is that a lot of the population of gamers tend to be introverts, people who re-energize by disconnecting from people, and that's probably a big reason why isolation games are so popular. But even someone like myself who leans towards the extroverted side can really appreciate these kinds of games. So today I want to take a look at some of my favorite isolation games and figure out just what it is that draws us into their lonely worlds and makes us want to stay there. And I'm gonna try to keep this as spoiler-free as possible, but there could be little beginning of game spoilers, so just you've been warned. I actually got the idea for this video a while back when the game Firewatch came out. It's a short indie game about a man who decides to run away from the problems in his life by becoming a fire lookout in the Wyoming wilderness. The way the game starts does such a great job immediately establishing that you're going to be cut off from the rest of the world. The gameplay cuts back and forth between the tear-jerking backstory of Henry, the main character, in which you get to make certain decisions about his past, and present-day Henry's trip out to the wilderness. It's so effective because the backstory and present-day segments seem unrelated at first. On one hand, you've got this narrator about Henry's life, and on the other hand, you've got this man making his way to his truck. Seems innocuous enough. But as the intro goes on and you learn about the tragic events of his past, you realize that you're playing out Henry's escape from the events of his life and his journey out into the wild, and it ties the two segments together and really puts some weight on your actions. One decision this game makes that I find to be very bold is never letting you see any other characters' faces. For starters, Delilah, who's essentially your boss and your guide for the entire game, is the only person you ever really talk to, and she only ever speaks to you over the radio. Early on in the game, you're tasked with busting these teenagers for shooting off fireworks in the woods, and when you find them, you can hear their voices, but all you see are silhouettes, which I honestly think is genius. The fact that these people are shown only as silhouettes adds to the feeling of loneliness even more than if there was nobody there to begin with, in my opinion, because it teases you with the idea that you might actually get some human contact, and then just kind of leaves you unsatisfied. Even the photo on Henry's desk of him and his wife sneakily covers her face with the camera. Honestly, it creates this huge disconnect and starts to make you kind of paranoid. Maybe you are really alone out here. Maybe Delilah's voice isn't coming through the radio at all. Maybe it's all in your head. One little detail really stood out to me in one of the earlier parts of the game. So like I mentioned, you have to bust these teenage girls for shooting off their fireworks, and afterward you stumble across a big mess they left behind for you as a way of saying thanks for ruining their fun. Well, the way this game allows you to examine things is actually by reporting them to Delilah over your radio. And Henry likes to report some super menial and unnecessary stuff, like getting stung by a bee.
I got stung by a bee.
And then there's this little message here on this rock that just says, "Go to hell." Henry can't report on it. The game doesn't even acknowledge it with some text. Just, "Go to hell." Right in your face. And I think that message isn't to Henry. I think it's to the player. I think it's the developers confirming the power they have over the player by saying, "You're out here all alone at the mercy of whatever we want to do to you. Neener neener. Go to hell." Maybe I'm reading too much into it, but that detail really drove the isolation home for me. Another nice touch were these supply caches you could access to find some extra exploring gear, but their main purpose was to bring the game world to life through notes, letters, and scraps left behind by other fire watchmen, which also served to just make you feel even more alone. This is a tactic used by just about every game I'm going to talk about today to drive home the isolation theme, finding evidence of past events. There was something going on here, but now there's just you. And you're alone. There are also these moments where, for whatever reason, Delilah is unable to be contacted on her radio, making you truly isolated out there. Firewatch does such an impressive job creating an immersive sense of loneliness, and the game is only a handful of hours long, so I definitely recommend it to anyone looking to escape from their world for a little while. BioShock is probably the big daddy of this genre, seeing as how it's a critically acclaimed AAA title infamous for its bone-chilling dystopian world and immersive storytelling. One of the biggest decisions this game makes right from the get-go is hiding the main character's identity. All you know is he might be named Jack? Sure, there are plot reasons for this, but you don't know that right away. You're just some dude trying to survive his way through the twisted remains of the once great underwater city of Rapture because a disembodied Irishman is telling you to. Much like Firewatch, your only forms of communication are through radios and intercoms. The game doesn't hide everyone's faces like Firewatch, but just about every other living thing you encounter is batshit crazy. You've always got that shred of hope that maybe you'll actually run into somebody that hasn't completely lost it, and every time you're let down, which serves to wear away at your sanity and make you feel more and more alone in this crazy world. Just the knowledge that the Splicers were at one time other people with lives and hopes and dreams, and that they've been reduced to these monsters makes you feel as if you're the lone sane person in this mad world, and I mean, You kind of are. Much like the cash box notes in Firewatch, it's common to find old recordings that do an excellent job of building the world around you, but also showing you that there once was something great here, and now there's just you. BioShock definitely borders on being a horror game at times, which is an interesting topic when you're discussing isolation games. It's a pretty obvious rule of horror that the player character should be isolated, but horror games use isolation merely as a tool to make the player afraid, rather than an entire thematic event of the game. Yeah, being alone is scary, but so is this. In BioShock, being alone is the whole point, and it just so happens to make the game pretty damn scary sometimes. I mean, this game's a classic, and you've probably played it, so I won't ramble on about it too much, but if you haven't, would you kindly do yourself a favor and get on that shit? I brought up the topic of horror games when talking about BioShock, and I think it's worth addressing in a video about games that make you feel isolated. Like I said, obviously horror games are going to isolate you. 99% of the time, being alone is going to be scarier than being with someone. So is it cheating to mention a horror game as a good example of isolation? Not when it's Silent freaking Hill! I'll be using Silent Hill 3 as my example here because it's my favorite of the series and the one I know the most intimately. So yeah, the vast majority of the time, your character, Heather, is alone in this game. But it goes so far above and beyond just putting you in situations where you're alone. It seems a common theme to limit the amount of human faces you see in isolation games, and Silent Hill 3 is no different. The game starts off with Heather asleep in a restaurant that's clearly in a normal world with normal rules. You can see the shadows of cars passing in the window and hear the sounds of the restaurant around her, but you never actually see any people other than the game's small cast of main characters. It's interesting how the game causes you to subconsciously assume you're in a populated mall where everything is normal, and then gradually fades it all away without you really noticing, until of course the point that it starts to get really weird, and then even Heather is saying, "Where the heck is everyone?" I'd say this is the main isolation technique Silent Hill uses. It constantly plays tricks on the player on a psychological level, allowing them to subconsciously let their guard down because their surroundings are just normal enough not to be concerning, and then allowing the twisted world of Silent Hill to stealthily creep in without them noticing until it's too late. And by too late, I mean when you suddenly find yourself scared shitless and you don't really know why. Your only hope for some kind of human interaction comes in the form of a cast of cryptic and unsettling characters that show up and disappear again on a whim. There's hardly ever a situation in which you can go back and talk to a character on your own terms. The game holds all the power over your loneliness and lets you interact with other characters on its terms. And they're usually less than reassuring anyway. It's that same idea of holding out for this glimmer of hope that maybe you'll run into somebody who's not out of their mind, and every time that fails to happen, you just feel more and more alone. Like BioShock and Firewatch, Silent Hill also uses the technique of littering the game world with notes and newspaper clippings as a world-building and isolation technique. The main difference is that in Silent Hill, you could be reading about something that happened, like, yesterday, which makes it all the more unsettling because, damn, what happened in such a short span of time that now things are looking this grim? Some events even seem to transpire just moments before you arrive, suggesting that someone was just there and now they're gone without a trace, which really throws the feeling of isolation in your face. If you want some downright horrifyingly isolating gameplay, I highly recommend the Silent Hill series, especially Silent Hill 2, 3, and 4. Another excuse to talk about Metroid? I'll take it! You can't talk about isolation in video games without talking about Metroid. I mean, you can, but you'd be an idiot! The Metroid series practically defined the genre of isolation games. The concept was so simple, a lone mission on an alien planet, and that's basically what every Metroid game is. The first couple of games definitely hit some of the right notes as far as isolation was concerned, but it wasn't really perfected until Super Metroid rolled around. Unlike every game I've talked about thus far, there are no lines of dialogue or text in Super Metroid except for the prologue at the very beginning, which mainly just serves to recap the previous two games. This game takes on the challenge of conveying everything to you through visual storytelling and letting the player piece it all together as they make their way through this eerily beautiful planet. In Super Metroid, there are legitimately no other human beings, unless you count these corpses in the intro level. Speaking of which, Metroid has always been a game that masterfully pulls off what I like to call aftermath porn. Not actual porn, but you know, like food porn or word porn. You just have to be the type of person who really enjoys it in a game when you're thrown into the aftermath of a situation and you're left to put the pieces together yourself. Metroid games are constantly making you say, "Oh, some shit went down," and then leaving you to discover precisely what shit on your own. And I mentioned before when talking about Silent Hill, arriving at the scene after everything has already gone down is a super lonely feeling. I've talked about this in a previous video, but the GFS Valhalla in Metroid Prime 3 is my favorite example of this. This Galactic Federation ship had been attacked by space pirates, but the state Samus finds it in suggests a lot more has actually happened, and it's such an awesome feeling exploring the aftermath of this battle all by yourself, discovering what happened bit by bit. But anyway, back to Super Metroid. So you touch touch down on planet Zebes and everything seems shut down, dead, abandoned. The only signs of life are these little vermin scurrying around the scenery. You find one special item and the lights flip on, the music changes, and the objects in the environment specifically go out of their way to single you out. Like this creepy spotlight that follows your movements, or these statue faces that turn and face you when you go up the elevator. I mean, that is some incredible attention to detail, and it serves the purpose of making you feel singled out, the lone hero on this totally hostile world. The feeling of isolation is so powerful that finding Decora and the Etacoon, silly little non-hostile aliens that teach you various jumping techniques, is an incredible breath of fresh air. Wow, they don't want to kill me at all! That shouldn't be that amazing, but you're so dang lonely that it is. The Metroid Prime games take a bit of a different approach by allowing you to scan your surroundings, another world-building technique just like finding notes in Firewatch, Bioshock, Silent Hill, etc. It's a perfectly legitimate isolation technique, and it works super well in Metroid Prime, but you've got to hand it to Super Metroid for taking the 100% non-verbal route. Amazingly impressive that a game that old is able to pull off something like that. There are plenty of other games that pull off the whole isolation thing amazingly well, so don't think of this video as any kind of comprehensive list. I just wanted to share some of my best experiences with you guys because I found that for some reason, I really like the way games like this make me feel. As always, thank you guys so much for watching this video. This is one I've been wanting to make for a while, actually ever since I played Firewatch, I've been wanting to make it. So here it is, it's done. Hope that you enjoyed it. If not, I'll do better. Hey, if you liked what you saw today, make sure you give this video a thumbs up, and you can subscribe to my channel for weekly content just like this. You better do it, or I'll kill you! As always, a huge shout out to all my supporters on Patreon, especially Rakti7, The Icarus Gambit, Angel Freisinger, Totter, the NM22, Mika Bunny, Donut Senpai, Kaioya, Jake Hester, Stooge, Mero Ochi, and Ragnaramus. You guys are awesome. You guys make this all possible. You guys keep me in business. You keep me able to do this as a job, as a career. So huge thanks to all you guys. If you want to support me on Patreon, just check out the link in the description of this video, and every bit counts. So, you know. Thank you. Okay, bye, for real.